and it became costly for the company. Then later on, the compensation plans were decided based on comparing the home country and the host country salary. Whichever was highest, that was decided to be given to the expatriates. Today we have a number of compensation systems that we will look into it in the next class. So which compensation system to use apply for an expatriate depends upon these three considerations. One is cost efficiency, whether the compensation plan is able to compensate the expatriate, which is cost effective for the company. It does not result in too much cost for the company. Equity issues is making sure that the compensation plan gives him almost equal salary what he was getting in the home country, somewhat similar equal to that he gets salary in the host country. System maintenance is making sure that the compensation plan is transparent, so the expatriate knows how his salary has been decided, and it is a plan which can be applied easily. Okay, so I'll stop here. Okay, hello HR students. We are continuing with module 2 in International Human Resource Management. I had started talking of compensation systems in the last class, how three considerations have to be given when the company is deciding on their compensation system. It should be cost effective for the company, and it should not increase the cost of the labor cost of the company. It should be equitable for the expatriate. That means the compensation system should be such that the expatriate is paid almost equal salary that he is getting in his home country, and the compensation system should be transparent and easy to apply. Now we'll start this class with the types of compensation system. The different types of compensation system is negotiation, localization, headquarter based balance sheet, home country based balance sheet. Negotiation is a type of compensation system where in those subsidiaries few expatriates are there. So the compensation of expatriates is negotiated with the expatriates and then decided. This is a simple concept. It cannot be applied when there is more number of expatriates in the subsidiary. Localization is a type of compensation system when the expatriate is on long-term assignments, or he has gone on permanent transfer, or it is for entry-level expatriates. For such kind of expatriates, the salary is given as per the local employees. This is also a simple concept. And the next one is headquarter-based balance sheet. When different nationalities of expatriates are working together in a subsidiary, and there is no discrimination between the nationality of expatriates, then the expatriates are paid as per their headquarter salaries. So, but this can lead to high compensation costs for the company, and it becomes difficult to repatriate TCNs. It becomes difficult to bring back third country nationals once they have completed their foreign assignments. Then we have the home country based balance sheet, where the expatriates are of different nationalities, and they will work on foreign assignments and they'll come back home to their home country. So for such kind of expatriates, this compensation is based on their home country. This leads to low compensation costs for the company, and but it is very complex. to administer in the subsidiary, and it's a simple concept. It is simple to repatriate the TCNs back into their home country. So now we will talk about balance sheet approach of compensation system. This is a very popular method of compensation system, which is mainly used in North American and European firms. This compensation system is so designed that the expatriate can maintain the same standard of living as that he was enjoying in his home country, irrespective of which location now he has been posted into. So the home country salary is broken into different components like goods, services, housing, tax, reserve, and then the home expenses and host country expenses of the expatriate is compared. And if the host country expenses are more, then the expatriate is compensated for that. He is paid extra to manage the increased expenses. So this approach is popular. Why it is popular is because it maintains the purchasing power of expatriates. The expatriates can enjoy the same standard of living as what they were enjoying in their home country, in their headquarters, and it is a cost-effective method too. But sometimes companies tend to overcompensate the expatriates. They tend to pay more to the expatriates. Upon repatriation, that is when the expatriate comes back after completing his foreign assignment, he is sent back to his home country. The expatriates complain about the less compensation they will start getting in the home country firm. And this balance sheet approach is simple in design, but it is complex to administer, and it has disadvantages, like it creates barriers between the expatriate and locals, especially those subsidiaries which are in economically backward countries. The locals there start resenting the expatriates because the expatriates are getting paid more. They are enjoying a better quality of lifestyle. So the local employees start resenting the expatriates in such subsidiaries. And since the expatriates are paid so well by the organization, some of the expatriates don't bother to be committed towards their work. They don't bother about getting results in their work. So what are the alternatives to the balance sheet approach of compensation system? When a company has heterogenic workforce, that means employees from different nationalities working together, then it is better they go for a global compensation package where they are not considering different nationalities of employees. So why they should follow a global compensation package can be explained by this example. Suppose the vice president of a US-based firm, he has been sent to Tokyo to head a local business unit over there. And the housing arrangements for that expatriate will be same as what he is getting in the US. But suppose this expatriate, US expatriate, is succeeded by a Japanese, does that mean the Japanese will not get any housing allowance? So this is the problem that arises with balance sheet approach of compensation system. So to avoid such problems, it is better for the subsidiary to go for a global compensation package. So for senior level expatriates, companies usually follow cafeteria approach of compensation system, which is tax and cost effective, but it cannot be applied to the lower level of expatriates. The weakness of the balance sheet system of compensation system is that it is tailored to the needs of the average expatriate. It cannot be applied to heterogenic expatriates. Usually international assignments are based on region, so salaries can be also designed based on regional conditions. So when the companies are paying different salaries to global expatriates and to regional expatriates, then it becomes necessary to monitor this difference in salaries, because the regional expatriates may start resenting the global expatriates who are paid better, so their commitment may suffer and their morals also may suffer. So when the companies are paying different salaries to global and regional expatriates, it needs to be monitored by the companies. Now we go to trends in global compensation. So there are different types of compensation systems, as we have seen in the last few slides, which satisfy different needs of expatriates. There are different categories of expatriates. You have senior level expatriates, middle level expatriates, and junior trainee expatriates. So compensation should be designed to suit the needs of different categories of expatriates. Their motives may be different. The motive may be corporate agency role or problem solving role or competence development role. So it is better for companies to pay seniors a unified compensation plan irrespective of their location, and for middle level professional expatriates, they can follow the balance sheet approach of compensation system. And for junior level and entry level expatriates, they can follow the local pay system. That means pay them according as per the local employees in subsidiaries. Or another option is company can follow one compensation system for those expatriates who are focused on their career, and another compensation system for those expatriates who are on short assignments. So which compensation system should a company follow? It needs to answer two questions. What are the category of expatriates in my company in the present or in the future? And should all categories of expatriates be paid by the same compensation system? So the answers to these questions depends upon the internationalization strategy of the company, whether it is following global integration strategy or localization strategy, or it is into strategic alliance. It depends upon HRM philosophy that the company is following, and it depends upon the mix of the expatriate population in the companies. So compensation is the only one factor which can motivate expatriates to work in a committed manner in their foreign assignments. There are some other non-financial rewards also which can motivate employees, like learning opportunities they would get for going on foreign assignments, the gains in the career they would get by going on foreign assignments. If an expatriate feels that he has been sent on a useless posting which is not helping his career, then by increasing his compensation package, his commitment will not increase. So compensation is not the only factor which can motivate expatriates. There are many other non-financial factors also which motivate expatriates more to be committed in their foreign assignments. Now we come to the last step of the expatriation process, that is repatriation and re-entry of the expatriates. After completing his foreign assignment, the expatriate comes back into his home country, comes back to his headquarters. This is not an easy job. It's a complex process. He has to rebuild his networks in the home organization. He has to make adjustments in his career. A particular expatriate must have enjoyed autonomy and freedom in his foreign assignment. He would have to give it up when he comes back home. Research has shown that when German and Japanese expatriates are coming back home, they are not repatriated successfully because they usually don't have good relations with headquarters and their career management is not done in a proper manner. So during repatriation, expatriates experience loss of social status, loss of financial benefits like COLA and expatriate premium, all those benefits they lose, financial benefits they lose, and they experience something known as reverse culture shock. This happens especially when an expatriate has been sent to a developed country from a developing or underdeveloped country where his home country is underdeveloped or developing, and he has been sent on a foreign assignment to a country which is developed. So the expatriate starts enjoying the high quality of lifestyle in his host country. So when he comes back, when he is repatriated back into his home country, he experiences something like a reverse culture shock. He has to get adjusted back into his low quality lifestyle in the home country. So this leads to high turnover among expatriates. Like most of the expatriates, after completing of their assignments, they quit the company and they join another company in the host country itself. So such kind of problems in repatriation can lead to high turnover among expatriates. So to avoid expatriation failure, such kind of expatriation failure, high performing expatriates should be visibly recognized and promoted when they come back home. That means they should be recognized and promoted in front of their colleagues, peers, and other office staff. So this will motivate other employees also to be ready to go on foreign assignments. And before doing repatriation of the expatriates, it should be planned well in advance so that the expatriate, once he comes back into his home country, he gets a meaningful position in his home country, and the company should provide logistic support, emotional support during the transition period, and they should have a continuous dialogue with the expatriate through their formal and informal networks. So companies like IBM, Shell, Lafarge, they have appointed people like career managers who monitor the expatriates' development throughout their assignment. So when the expatriate has been away for 3 to 4 years from their headquarters, they experience something known as demotion. They feel they have been demoted. This is a common experience that is seen among most expatriates. So in Coca-Cola, the employees are given repatriation counseling and they are given a safety net of 1 year to find a suitable position in the headquarters once they come back into headquarters company. So successful repatriation of an expatriate depends on the first step of the expatriation process, that is careful selection of the expatriates. So once the expatriate has been carefully selected, you select employees who have an excellent track record, domestic career track record, so that Once they finish their assignment, it is easier to place them in good jobs in the headquarters once they return back into their home country. Beyond the traditional expatriate model. So nowadays, you know, companies are going more and more into internationalization. That is, they are growing more and more their international business. So expatriates experience a lot of tensions because they are working with different nationality of expatriates. There is increasing number of women in the workforce. TCNs, third country nationals, are more in number, and younger expatriates are joining the workforce, and most of the expatriates have to adjust to dual career where both the husband and wife are working. So all these adjustments lead to tensions in the expatriate. There are five types of tensions which the expatriates go through. One is the home or host tensions. When expatriates are present in the subsidiary, it creates tension among the locals. Because the expatriates know very well their parent company culture. They know more about their parent company culture, and they are knowing less about the local culture of the subsidiary. So they become insensitive to the local culture there. And the expatriates are being paid more than the locals. They enjoy a higher standard of living than the locals. So this creates resentment among the locals. But the expatriates are valuable for the subsidiary because they bring in local business. So this leads to home or host tensions between the expatriates and locals. Then the second type of expatriate tension is the global or local tensions. When in a subsidiary, most of the top positions are occupied by expatriates, and the local people, the local managers who are capable, they are not given the chance to occupy these top positions. They get discouraged. So either they leave their jobs or they become less committed towards their work. So this kind of resentment increases within the subsidiary. Even though the expatriate may be bringing in lot of benefits like better control of subsidiary operations or easy communication with headquarters, but because of this increasing resentment, it leads to global or local tensions. As the foreign operations increase, the locals become more experienced in handling the subsidiary operations. So there is less requirement of expatriates, and the operations shift into localization. That is, the local employees become expert in handling the operations themselves. So there is less requirement of expatriates. Now, short or long-term tensions. Most of the expatriates, they prefer taking short-term decisions, which is limited to the duration of their assignments. They avoid taking long-term decisions, especially those decisions which are costly or risky. So here, for example, in Japan, a foreign airline subsidiary, they had a labor contract which was negotiated by an expatriate, but the expatriate did not negotiate the labor contract properly. So it led to years of inflated labor cost for the subsidiary. Because the contract was not negotiated properly, it led to increased labor cost for the subsidiary. But this labor contract was not renegotiated by any subsidiary because it would have triggered a strike among the local employees. The local employees would have gone on a strike if the labor contract was renegotiated. So no expatriate was willing to take such kind of a risk. So this is known as short long term tensions. It leads to short long term tensions. And some young expatriates, in order to impress the headquarters, they make unnecessary changes in the subsidiary. This also creates resentment and tension among the local employees and creates tension between the expatriate and local employees. Then we have tension between cost and investment. As you know, expatriates have to be paid very high compensation. Their shifting of expatriates to the foreign country, repatriation of foreign countries, maintenance of expatriates in foreign countries, all that is very expensive for the company, and it leads to increased labor costs for the companies. But still, companies do try to reduce their expatriation costs by bringing in more localization, by making the local employees more skilled in handling the subsidiary operations. But still, expatriation is required when the company is trying to build itself into a transnational firm. When it is trying to build its international business, expatriates are very much required by the company. Firms usually follow a cost-driven expatriation strategy. That means when the company is doing good, they send more number of expatriates to their foreign subsidiaries. When the company is not doing good, when recession has happened, then they send less number of expatriates on foreign assignments. Then you have demand and supply tensions. As the company's international business increases, there is more demand for experienced, capable expatriates. But at the same time, expatriates are not willing to go on foreign assignments because of the educational concerns of the children, or because they have aged parents, they need to take care of them, or because of their spouse's career, they are unwilling to go on foreign assignments. So this creates a tension because there is a gap between demand and supply of expatriates. So this leads to tension amongst the expatriates, between the expatriate and the companies. So I'll stop the class here. We will deal with this topic, changing demographics of expatriate population, in the next class.